Penguin Random House Audio presents Robert B. Parker's Buckskin. This is the author, Robert Knott. For Julie. Chapter 1. An all-day celebration had been taking place. The sounds of music, dancing, people talking and laughing echoed inside the jailhouse. The blue-eyed kid with the busted lip and bruised face sat on his cell bunk, sharpening a spoon handle to a point. He wore a huge sombrero and a short-waisted Mexican jacket. He favored the Mexican culture over the American way of living, but he was no Mexican. Ever since he was on his own, he'd spent most of his time drifting from town to town along the border. He preferred the Mexican people, especially the señoritas. And the señoritas took a liking to him as well. He was fond of the Mexicans' food and Mexicans' drinks, too. Mezcal was his favorite. And he spoke the Spanish language well, or well enough to get what he wanted. When he was in one place long enough and feeling generous, he would wire or write a letter to the old man. The old man was the only person the kid had any tether to on the earth. The kid was never sure how he ended up with the old man, who the old man even was, or where he came from. The kid had a vague memory of moving from one family to another as a child. Until one day when the kid could put on his own breeches, an old man came and took him away. The old man took him to the mountains and put him to work. The whistling sound of fireworks interrupted the waltz that played in the plaza. The kid sprang up and stood atop his bunk. He could see through the bars of his cell window the tail end of the skyward firework. Then it exploded and brightened the night sky. "Hot damn," he said. "Hot damn." Another one launched and exploded. "Damn, I was sure looking forward to this here celebration. I sure was."
"I told you to shut up before I come in there and shut you up for good," the jailer said. "Shut your mouth."
The kid laughed.
"Like to see you try. Like to see you try. I know more than get to town here yesterday, and what happens? You lock me up, and for no reason. No reason at all. Two biggins like you and your soldier blue buddy slapping me around. You should be ashamed. Besides, I was leaving tomorrow. I gotta be someplace soon. I told you that, didn't I? I have someplace to be, you see."
More fireworks lit up the sky. One after another after another. A large pinwheel was lit, spewing sparks that cast a bright glow on the kid's boyish face. He beamed like a child, watching in awe.
"You ought to see this. Boy, oh boy."
He watched, wishing he was part of the fireworks and festivities taking place on the town's plaza. The band ended the slow waltz and started up with a lively tune that brought hoots and hollers from the crowd.
"I should be out there among them. Not in here, out there. How about letting me out? I should be out there."
"I told you to shut your mouth."
"I should."
He watched for a minute, then said,
"Land's alive. Food smells good out there. Don't it? I'm hungry as a bear. If you won't let me out, why don't you go out? You should go out, dance, and have some fun. Get something to eat, and bring me back something, too. No reason to sit in here with little old me. Hell, what am I gonna do? Nothing. That is damn sure plain to see. Nothing."
The jailer was fuming, but didn't glance up from the newspaper he was reading as the kid continued.
"You know as well as me that it doesn't make good sense, me being in here and all. Hell, I was doing nothing. I was minding my own business yesterday. I was passing through. I'm heading up north. I got business up north. Important business.
The jailer continued to ignore the kid, who'd been talking nonstop since he got locked up.
I could have danced right off, you know? I should have. But I didn't. Know why?
The jailer spoke without looking up from the newspaper. 'Cause you was riding a dead man's horse?
I won that horse fair and square. Wasn't my fault that drunk put his pony on the table 'cause he had no money.
The jailer lowered his newspaper, then tipped back in his chair so he could see the kid eye to eye, but said nothing as he stared at him.
I won that pony. Even got a bill of sale.
He pulled a piece of paper from his pocket, jumped down from the bunk, and moved to the bars. He held out the paper, waving it at the jailer.
Take a look, see. Why don't you? I tried to show you and the other brass button bastard this, but you wouldn't look at it. I didn't do nothing wrong, nothing at all. Here, take a look. I didn't have nothing to do with shooting that fella. Got this telegram, too.
He removed a telegram from his pocket.
Requesting I come as soon as possible.
Shut up, kid.
I didn't. I was nowhere near that cantina where he got shot. I mean, yeah, I had been there earlier, like I said, when I won the pony, but was nowhere near there when it happened.
Save that crap for the judge.
You don't know nothing. You're a dumb shit is all.
What'd you say, boy?
You heard me.
Don't you push me, boy. I've had enough of your yapping.
What? What you gonna do?
The jailer stared at the kid, and the kid could tell he was getting to him. The kid smiled.
You're just one of those dumb shit soldier boys. One of those that follow orders, 'cause you can't think for yourself. I should have just danced right off.
Keep it up, and I will come in there and dance your ass around till you quit breathing. Save the court money.
Fuck you, dumb shit.
The jailer slammed down his newspaper. He lifted out of his chair, snatched the keys from the desk, and marched to the cell. The kid moved away from the bars as the jailer fumbled with the keys, trying to unlock the cell.
No need to get all worked up, the kid said. The kid was small, not tall at all, and 130 pounds, soaking wet.
He backed away as the cell door opened and the burly jailer charged him. He slapped the kid so hard blood flew from the kid's mouth and splattered on the wall. He hit him a second time, sending another stream of blood flying in the opposite direction. The next strike came from the kid. It was swift and to the jailer's throat, and it was the sharp spoon handle that burrowed into the man's neck. The jailer felt his neck where blood was flowing. He reached for the kid, but the kid was swift and moved out of his grasp. Then the kid kicked the jailer hard in the groin and stabbed him again. Another blow to the jailer's neck. The jailer stumbled, hurt and bleeding. He dropped on the bunk and the kid stabbed him again. And again. Then the kid held up the stabbing tool. He showed the spoon knife to the jailer. The jailer was now weak, and blood flowed from the many wounds to his neck.
This here spoon was from that lousy plum pudding your asshole buddy gave me yesterday. That was all I had to eat. You realize that?
The jailer stared at the kid and blood poured out of his neck and bloomed out across the front of his shirt.
You dumb fuck, the kid said. You and him didn't have smarts enough to make sure you got the pudding spoon back, did you? I was up all night working on this, while you and that Yankee friend of yours were playing checkers with each other like little children. Telling each other lie after lie about how you did this or how he did that. I was working on this. I
told you I had business to attend to, didn't I? Didn't I? Now look at you. All you had to do was go out, like I said, and have some fun. Bring me something to eat, and this might not have happened. But it's happened now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.